The Valparaiso University Student Senate election and changes for next year's election. Just how big this change is.
And in this week's Around Valpo segment, we look at a taco truck that is operated by Valpo students.
And we've seen some thunderstorms pop up across central Illinois. I'll give you all the details on that and full weather coming up. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Jake. We'll have that and more. This edition of The Shield starts right now.
Live from the VUTV studio in Schnabel Hall on the campus of Valparaiso University. This is The Shield on VUTV.
Thank you for joining us on The Shield. I'm Eric Rzanski.
And I'm Caitlin Williams.
Someone like Valpo's student body president-elect could never run again. A new amendment to the Student Senate Constitution requires Senate experience before running for office. VUTV's Brendan Johnson asks the question, why now?
The student body of America's largest independent Lutheran university elects its first Muslim student body president. And you'd think that would be tonight's story, but it's not. It's this. The rules by which he was elected, well, they've just changed.
Junior status, 45 credits, and a 2.5 GPA. That's what it takes to be the president of the student body here at Valpo. But as of April 3rd, Senate has added a new requirement to that position. Students must now have 2 semesters of Senate experience in order to be considered a candidate for president. The new president-elect hasn't held a Senate seat, but he thinks his inexperience might give him the upper hand.
I think inexperience can help me in the fact that I won't be as hesitant. I will have probably more ideas coming in that I won't have in the back of my mind, oh, I can't do this, I can't do that.
The amendment comes on the heels of the unusual election, but the senator who sponsored the Senate resolution says it's been on the books for quite some time.
It's something I've been passionate about doing for a while, because I think it's really important that we have people with experience at the helm.
And at the end of the day, Senate leadership says it all boils down to choice.
It's really a matter of what kind of pool are we offering students to choose from when selecting the future president.
As for Hussein, he might disagree with the change, but he's celebrating another victory.
I am Muslim, and that many people saw past that, or saw through it, I guess, and thought he still can represent me as a person that will think for the betterment of the school.
Reporting for VUTV, I'm Brendan Johnson.
The new requirement will come into effect next school year. A similar resolution for vice presidential candidates will also be brought to the Senate floor. It failed to reach that 7/8 vote requirement.
Valparaiso University 2015-2016 alumni have achieved a 96% graduate placement rate, up nearly 4% from last year. 2015-2016 alumni have secured work or are studying in 36 states, the District of Columbia, as well as 9 countries outside the United States. This marks the 24th straight year that more than 90% of Valpo graduates have been employed or enrolled in graduate school.
Professor Andrew Stem of the Communications Department here on campus will sadly be leaving Valparaiso University after this semester. VUTV reporter Marguerite Incardoni had the chance to sit down with Professor Stem and talk about his Valpo career as well as what is next for him.
I started here in 2001 as an undergrad. Where I grew up was about an hour from here. The comm department was great. Dr. Steinwart was here at the time. I had her for Comm 100 in the fall of 2001. Valpo was small, but had the opportunity to make of it what I wanted. They had a journalism major, which not a lot of places had, and I knew I wanted to write. So graduated in 2005 and wandered for a little while. I ended up going to the University of Michigan and getting a master's degree, and I considered getting a PhD and then didn't, and ended up back here pursuing a master's in sports media. Valpo had always felt like home, so was able to come back and do 2 years of classes and get another degree. And then I was very fortunate that Dr. Lutze, who'd come in to serve as the chair of the department, and John Ruff, who was at that time the director of the core program, basically got together and cobbled something so that they could offer me a position to stay and teach. The interaction with students is second to none. The people here, from students to faculty to staff, everybody is just tip top. My wife, Megan, was offered a new job. She accepted a position at Creighton in Omaha. She's their director of international enrollment. It's a really big deal for her. She's really, really excited and is getting to do a lot of traveling internationally to recruit students. I will be moving this summer to be with her, and we'll get the four of us reunited, I guess, which will be pretty good. The goal is to keep teaching. I had been looking at PhD programs and not having initially as much success as I was hoping for, but I'm thinking that will turn out to be a blessing in disguise so I can pursue what I really want to pursue. In the meantime, I'm going to look into their community colleges and other universities in Omaha. I'm going to try and see if I can do some adjunct work just to keep teaching and then figure out my plan from there. So it's still a little bit up in the air, but I remain hopeful, and hopefully we'll eventually try and get to the point where I can end up back here someday.
Registration for the 2017 Color for a Cause is now open. You can sign up now by going to tinyurl.com/registerc4c.
The Chemistry Club held its second annual Women in STEM Dinner and Discussion, where faculty, students, and the community gathered together and discussed gender-based issues that women face in the STEM field. The club secretary and event organizer Mariah Carmel gave us an overview of the event.
So we're having a formal dinner in the union, and then it'll just be some informal conversations between students and the faculty, and then we're going to transition into a more formal panel where students will be able to ask questions, and then it's really a discussion, you know, between the students and the faculty, and we can just talk about some issues and concerns. Some questions that people asked last year were questions about like work and family balance. How do you have a family and also pursue your PhD and work, you know, as a professor?
Valpo alumni, faculty, and professionals from all over shared their insights on the difficulties these professions offered advice for hopeful students.
Applications for the summer 2017 housing are now available. Current students can access the summer housing application via their housing self-service via DataVU. The Office of Residential Life must receive applications for summer housing by 5 p.m. on Friday, April 28, 2017. The cost is $1,500 per summer session.
And in this week's Around Valpo segment, we take you out to Chunky's Tacos, a student-run taco truck that offers Valpo students quality Mexican food. We had the opportunity to sit down with the owner of Chunky's and learned why he decided to open up his own business.
Really, there's no late-night option or anything quick and easy just to grab that's tasty in Valpo. And really nothing trendy, you know. I'm from Chicago, where there's always so much going on and so many different things to get to eat. And I felt that we could use some of that. The students deserve something, you know? But the truck we actually got in Houston, we were so naive at the start that we thought we were flying to Houston and buy this truck that the eBay seller was mint condition, ready to rock and roll. And we got there in 20 minutes into purchasing the truck. And like after we finished the final transaction, everything, we're about 5 minutes away from where we bought it, and it just breaks down completely. The cabin fills with exhaust, and we're just at like 10 p.m. in the middle of nowhere in Houston, just stranded. But we ended up getting it transported, not towed, across the United States to Chicago. I contracted one of my childhood friends to actually paint the truck, and I gave him I trusted his artistic discretion, and I'm like, you know me? And he actually ended up picking my nickname for the restaurant name. I'm like, we don't have a name set in stone, so like, just play around with it. And this idea struck him, and he went with it, and immediately I saw it, I'm like, this is it. This is, we are Chunky's.
We want the food to be for the students because we are students, you know. Being able to be a part of Chunky's Tacos and know that we're producing really good food and, you know, serving students that don't have that close of an option. And they could just walk here and get some tacos, and it's pretty cheap.
We serve tacos, steak, chicken, and veggie, and we're working in quesadillas now, and then we'll do nachos down the line.
The tentative opening date for Chunky's Tacos is April 17th. However, to stay up to date with where they are and when they are open, you can follow them on Facebook at Chunky's Tacos Valpo.
We have had some phenomenal weather recently, and we are hoping that trend will keep up. Storm Shield meteorologist Jake Van Horn is in the studio with us right now. Jake, does it look like this weather will continue?
Well, Katie and Eric, we have seen some of that phenomenal weather over the last couple of days or so, but we're not experiencing that right now. And then later on into this evening, we're going to see some storms possible. We're going to see the return of seasonable temps, And later on this week, we will also see some sunshine. I want to jump ahead to radar real fast. This pink is a severe thunderstorm watch, which is in effect until 10 o'clock tonight. I'll go into more detail later on. And we're watching this cell right now. So it's important overnight tonight to have a severe weather plan. So that includes a NOAA weather radio. Listen for weather alerts as you go overnight tonight and know when to take action if severe weather happens.
Thanks, Jake. Coming up, a gunman in Wisconsin is on the run after mailing a dangerous manifesto to the president.
Plus, Egypt struggles to recover from repeated bombings on the Coptic churches. We'll have that and more up next.
Early this morning, there was a shooting at North Park Elementary School in San Bernardino, California. This shooting was believed to be a murder-suicide, according to San Bernardino police. A female victim was killed and a male died of self-inflicted gunshot wound. The relationship between the man and the woman is unknown at this time, according to San Bernardino Police Lieutenant Michael Madden. Two students were also injured and are listed in critical condition at area hospitals. Police do not believe that the students were targeted, rather that they happened to be near the female adult during the shooting.
And the search is still on for 32-year-old Joseph A. Jubowski. He's suspected of stealing weapons from a gun shop in Rock County, Wisconsin last week. Police say that same day he set his car on fire, threatened to harm schools or public officials, and mailed a 161-page manifesto to President Trump detailing anti-government grievances. The FBI is offering a $10,000 reward for information leading to his arrest. Police say if you see Jubowski, do not approach him. Call 911 immediately as he is considered armed and dangerous.
Egyptian state television channels Nile and Al Masira are now reporting a total of 43 killed and 119 wounded in the bombings at two Coptic churches in Alexandria and Tanta on Palm Sunday. State media is reporting 27 people died and 78 were wounded in the attack on St. George's Church in Tanta in Alexandria. The attack on St. Mark's Coptic Orthodox Cathedral left 16 dead and another 41 wounded. State TV is reporting Egyptian President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi is declaring 3 days nationwide mourning following the two Palm Sunday bombings.
Russia's foreign minister is reportedly calling for an investigation into U.S. missile strikes in Syria. According to a Russian government post on its Facebook page, Sergei Lavrov made the decision during a phone conversation with Secretary of State Rex Tillerson Saturday. The post also says that Lavrov dismissed a U.S. assertion that Syria used chemical weapons earlier this week. He also said the missile strike would only help extremists in Syria and hurt global security. Tillerson and Lavrov are set to meet in Moscow next week.
A nationwide retailer is ending its 62-year run. H.H. Gregg said on Friday that it's going out of business and shutting down its 220 stores. The going out of business sales at H.H. Gregg stores got underway Saturday The Indiana retail chain filed for bankruptcy last month and talked to dozens of potential buyers. But its CEO said the company could not close the deal within the timeline set by creditors.
The newest addition to the Memphis Zoo made her debut Friday. This baby hippo was born on March 23rd, weighing in at 67 pounds. Zoo creators say the little girl takes to stay close to her mother. You can also see her prancing around and going for a swim. The hippo doesn't have a name just yet, but the Memphis Zoo is holding a contest to choose one. People can go on the zoo's website and vote on a name, choosing between Venus, Cleo, Winnie, Zuri, or Asha. Voting will end April 13th.
Up next, Storm Shield meteorologist Jake Van Horn will have your full forecast.
And coming up later, Jordan Morandini will have the recap of this past week's Crusader Sports. Stick with us.
Hello and welcome back to The Shield. I'm Storm Shield meteorologist Jacob Van Horn. As you can see behind me on I-65, we've seen some sunshine scattered throughout the day, and we're going to continue to see that over the next couple of hours or so. You can see right now 68 degrees and cloudy in Valparaiso, a wind out of the south-southwest at 17 miles per hour. We're not the only warm spot across the area. As you can see back into Illinois, we have places like Springfield coming in at 72, Peoria at 70, and 69 down in Champaign as well. Now, the big news story tonight is these storms. You can see the pink is a severe thunderstorm watch, which has been issued by the National Weather Service until 10 o'clock tonight. You can see these storms have been firing up all afternoon, really from southern Wisconsin back into Illinois. Now, this cell right here that's moving into Kankakee was severe thunderstorm warned. They've allowed that warning to expire now, but we're going to keep monitoring that as we move forward. We're going to go ahead and zoom in just a little bit here. You can see we've had some scattered showers across the area in the 4 o'clock hour in Valpo. And you can see off back to our west, this is that storm that was severe thunderstorm warned. That's going to be moving into our area as well. I'm going to go ahead and time this out for you. You can see this line in central Illinois. By the time we get into 11 o'clock tonight, you can see that begins to move out of our area. By the time we get into Tuesday morning, you're heading off to classes, we're going to see some cloud cover. But by the time we get into your Tuesday evening, and especially into your Wednesday morning, we're going to see plenty of clear conditions. Your forecast for tonight, a low of 44. We're going to see those showers and thunderstorms. Wind out of the west-northwest at 10 to 20 miles per hour. Tomorrow, a little bit cooler and seasonable, a high of 57. We're going to see the return of that sunshine, though. And as we go ahead and we look at your 7-day forecast, you can see we're going to cool down Tuesday night, a low of 38 degrees, but then we really begin to climb again, a little bit above average. 63 for Wednesday, 66 for your Thursday. Friday, we have a chance of seeing some more showers. Nothing severe, though. Mostly a rain event. High of 68. We climb again for Saturday up to 78. And then we come crashing down just a little bit with some morning thunderstorms on Sunday. So overall, not too terrible of a forecast moving forward.
And now, Jake, I mean, you mentioned that we're under a severe thunderstorm watch right now. Just for the viewers at home, what does that exactly mean here? What are we looking at for this evening?
So whenever we're talking about a watch, really it's that the conditions are favorable for severe thunderstorms. So if you're outside today, you notice how warm it was.
Yeah, it was kind of a little bit muggy, too.
Yeah.
We should get that mug-o-meter up there. I know I don't think we have it, though, but, Brendan, one of our storm sheet meteorologists, he likes to throw that on there. But thanks, Jake. After the break, Jordan Morandini will have a full breakdown of this past week's Crusader Sports.
Welcome back to The Shield. I'm Jordan Morandini. Things didn't look great for Valpo softball with heavy rain in the forecast early last week, but somehow, some way, with amazing work done on the field, the Crusaders found a way to host Green Bay in a three-game series. And the series was a doubleheader Tuesday and a single game Wednesday. The Crusaders fell in the first game 4-3, but bounced back in a huge way in games 2 and 3. In game 2, Sam Stewart had the big hit, a grand slam, which took Valpo's lead to 9-0 at that point, and they finished winning game 2 13-2. And in game 3, it was Mackenzie Grossman who was fantastic in the circle for the Crusaders, throwing a complete game shutout and giving up just 7 hits. The transfer improved her record to 12-5 with the win. And Valparaiso will be back in action this upcoming Tuesday for another midweek Horizon League series, this time hosting UIC. And for the baseball team, they were finally happy to be home after playing 26 straight on the road to open up the season. The Crusaders hosted Northern Kentucky for a 3-game set that opened with a doubleheader on Saturday. And the Crusaders came out and took care of business in games 1 and 2, both close, but wins 8-7 and 10-9. In both games, the Crusaders led by 3 or more, but Northern Kentucky cut the deficit to just 1 late. The Norse came into the weekend the number one offense in the Horizon League, and they showed exactly why in game 3, putting up 18 runs. It was a tough day for the Crusaders pitching staff as 6 different pitchers threw for Valpo, and each of them gave up at least 1 earned run. But nonetheless, it was a big series win for the Crusaders, who improved at 3-6 in Horizon League play, and they will look to keep it going this Thursday when they host Oakland for the first of a 3-game series. And now it's time for something new we added last week to our VU TV Sports Arsenal. And it's time for the sports or the play of the week. And for that, let's head to Denver, where Russell Westbrook broke the all-time record for triple doubles in a season and then did that. A fantastic three-point shot that capped off a 50-point, 16-rebound, and 10-assist game for the Thunder star. The triple double was his 42nd of the season, passing Oscar Robertson for the record. And the Thunder finished winning 106-105 over Denver. So, guys, it was a fun week of sports.
Absolutely. Well, thank you, Jordan. We'll be right back with a final look at your weather forecast.
So moving forward over the next couple of days, we're going to see the storms move out and a little bit of a warm-up and the return of some sunshine. So overall, pretty good forecast moving forward.
Beautiful. Looking forward to it. Well, for Katie, Jake, Jordan, and myself, thank you for watching, and we will see you in 2 weeks on The Shield.